Don's whole sort of hobby horse was he thought it was inappropriate to take wine to pieces, that you couldn't understand it with the aroma wheel. So what he did was he had a Beaujolais Nouveau, a nice Pinot with some bottle age, and a big bad Cabernet. And he gave us this Mozart Divertimento, which is a silly kind of piece of music, and then something from Franz Liszt with a whole lot of violas and French horns, and Carmina Burana, which is a very dark piece. And he said, you know, match them up. And it isn't very hard. You put the silly little musical piece with the silly little Beaujolais, and, you know, you put the big, heavy, angry music with the big, heavy, angry Cabernet, and like that. When we play Carmina Burana, the Beaujolais was actually nastier than the Cabernet. The Cabernet got sweet and round. And that's what I want to show you. Matches and mismatches. All right, so we got these three wines. So now I'm going to change the environment and see if I can make all that change. I've got little clips, like 10-second clips of both pieces, and we're gonna go back and forth. What I'm doing here is matching the emotional modality that's in the music with the one that's in the wine. What I'm really telling you is wine is liquid music. If the third wine was a piece of music, what kind of music would it be?
Something makes you think a little deeper.
Yeah, what I find is my wines really like contemporary jazz. So this is Pavarotti.
Interesting to see the combinations, yes.
The moments you have with wine and music, and it's all an experience.
I really do think that there is a huge difference with the music and the change in the flavors. I guess it's having to do with the way the brain works, so. But it was actually a lot of fun.
I think it worked. I definitely think that wine and music are intrinsically connected, and it's fun to think about the ways that they tie together. And I definitely could never have drunk that Sutter Home White Zinfandel without the music that he played. So that must have worked.